We can use fixed points to analyze the behavior of autonomous differential equations. Indeed, we've already done so in section 2.1, population models. Let's demonstrate this via an example. Here's an autonomous differential equation. We'll use this in our example. And this provides a good example as well of the power of analyzing differential equations without actually solving them. Because what would happen if you tried to solve this? Well, it is separable. All autonomous differential equations are separable. But in practice, can you integrate this? I don't know how to integrate this. Instead, we'll gain useful information about the differential equation without having to do a difficult calculus. We'll start with the observation that this thing has two fixed points. The zero product property says, remember that the fixed points are when the derivative is equal to zero. And the zero product property says that if you're multiplying things together and they equal zero, one of the things you're multiplying has to be zero. We're multiplying three terms, which gives us three potential fixed points. However, e to the x equals zero has no solutions. So we don't get any fixed points from that. And that what we're going to do now may seem very familiar. You'll have seen stuff like this in calculus one when you learned the first derivative test. We'll create a number line and we'll mark our fixed points. And because this is continuous, these fixed points are the only place where the derivative can change sign. That is to say, in this region, the derivative is either always positive or always negative. In this region, always positive or always negative. In this region, always positive or always negative. So select any number in this region, say -3, and plug it into this expression. We get the negative number back again, or sorry, we get a positive number back again. -3 - 1 = -4. -3 + 2 = -1. A negative times a negative is a positive. e^-3 is also positive. So this product is positive. And because it was positive somewhere in this interval, it's positive everywhere in this interval. And then you just repeat that, this interval between -2 and 1. It's either always positive or always negative. Select any number in this interval, say 0. If we plug 0 in here, we do get a negative number. So since it's always positive or always negative, and it's negative somewhere, it's negative at zero, it's negative everywhere in this interval. And over here, the derivative is positive. Pick any number greater than one, say two, plug it in here, you'll get a positive number back again. So what information is this giving us? Well, remember, we're thinking of, you know, x as moving up and down this line as time passes, and the sign of the derivative tells us which direction we're going in. Positive derivatives, we're going right. Negative derivatives, we're going left. So qualitatively, we now completely understand this differential equation. Say that we have any initial condition. Say we're told that x of zero equals three. What's going to happen? Well, we start here at three. We see the derivative is positive, so we go to the right, and we keep going to the right forever. X increases to infinity as time passes. What if instead x of zero equaled zero? Well, we're starting here. The derivative is negative. As time passes, we go to negative two. X asymptotically approaches negative two as time passes. So for any initial condition, we can describe in a general sense what happens as time passes. Now, of course, this isn't perfect. What we don't get from this is any quantitative information. How fast is x going to infinity? How fast is x approaching negative two? We don't get that kind of data. We just get sort of long-term descriptive data of what happens. But sometimes that's all you need. I mean, think back to the population models. The population goes extinct. The population approaches the carrying capacity. This kind of long-term information gives us very useful information in that example.